So it's my great pleasure to be here to present our recent results regarding photochemistry on quantum-sized metal nanoparticles that refer to the small-sized metal nanoparticles. Okay. So photochemistry, what's photochemistry? Photochemistry refers to the process of absorbing photo energy to drive chemical reactions, right? So we know the energy stored in photons, that represents the ultimate energy, we can have, right, from the nature. So the photon has, a quantum parameter like this. So for a chemical reaction, chemical reaction represents a rearrangement process of electrons. That's the electron pair, of chemical bond among different molecules, right? So we know electrons have, different quantum parameters, from the photon. So that means, directly coupling, the photon and electrons, it's not very efficient. That means, it's not very efficient to, couple the photon energy with the chemical bond to drive a chemical reaction. So how can we, more efficiently bridge, the photon and chemical bond, right? So one way, so we can use, some objects which, have, high density of electrons, such as metal nanoparticles, have very high density of free electrons as a mediator to bridge them. So when we use metal nanoparticles, which can strongly absorb, light, right? So that in that case, the free electrons, in the metal nanoparticle can be excited, can be elevated to high energy levels. So we call these excited, electrons as hot electrons. So the high electron means, the electrons that gain high, kinetic energy, that can be accelerated in the electric field for our light. So, here we have, high electrons. So the electron have to be transferred into the surface adsorbing molecules in order to drive a chemical reaction. So that means we need the following, injection of high electrons into surface adsorbers, right? So high electron injection, can occur only when the hot electrons have high enough energy that can overcome the potential barrier necessary to break the interfacial states to allow the electrons, transfer from the metal nanoparticle into the surface orbits. All right, so once the electrons, sorry, I need, there's something pop up. Sorry. So once the electrons, injected into surface orbits, so in the where electron will go, right? Electrons will in general will be injected into the empty antibonding orbitals, or it's empty, it's Lumo orbitals, right? So once the electrons inject into the empty, orbitals, so the adsorbers can leave the metal surface and take the hot electrons away. So with them, so that can form, a radical anion, for example, superoxide anions. So in this case, it's because the reacting species it's changed, so that can change their chemical reactivity. Change, that means change the following chemical reactions. So another case, another scenario, the adsorbers still stay on the metal surface, but because the injection of the high electrons as it's empty, it's antibonding orbitals, so that can elevates the energy of the adsorbing molecules, right? Can to weaken the chemical bond. That means facilitates the cleavage of a chemical bond and allow the desired chemical reactions. After that, so the electrons can flow back to the metal to recombine with the holes. So why do we need, you know, the small particle size? So because we say that when we reduce the particle size, you know, to a certain level, it can benefit both hard electron generation and hard electron injection. Let's say, you know, for the atoms, in an atom, you know, so all the electrons are, you know, so confined in the well-defined energy levels, right? So the electron, you know, even for the valence band electrons, they have to stay, you know, so in the specific energy level. But only when they, you know, so a lot of, you know, so metal atoms are condensed together to form, you know, so bulk, you know, so objects. So the, you know, so the density of energy states, you know, becomes, you know, it's significant, and the valence band electrons becomes, you know, become free electrons. They can move freely in the metal, right? So, you know, for when we reduce the size of the metal objects down to tens of nanometers, for example, above, you know, around 50 nanometers, which is comparable to the mean free pass of electrons in metal. So the size dependent surface plasma redness behavior can occur that can enhance, can, you know, enable strong light absorption in the metal nanoparticles, right? For example, the, you know, it's a gold and silver, they are very typical plasmonic nanoparticles. So we can say, you know, so the light absorption in the metal nanoparticles can, you know, can, you know, excite electrons, you know, to generate hot electrons with high energy near the surface of the nanoparticle, as well as the, you know, it's lukewarm, you know, drilled electrons within the nanoparticles. So you can say the hot electron generation efficiency, you know, significantly increases as the particle size decreases, in particular when the particle size smaller than 10 nanometers. Right? So that tells us, you know, it's reducing the particle size, you know, can increase the efficiency of hot electron generation. On the other hand, so we care about the hot electron injection across the, you know, so the interface, metal adsorbing interface, right? So we can say that this, you know, the electron transfer process refers to a, you know, the electrical property because, you know, it involves the electron movement, right? So we can say, you know, it's a when the particle size decreases down to about 10 nanometers, the Coulomb blockade effect can emerge. The Coulomb blockade effect refers to that, you know, it's injecting a electron into a small metal nanoparticle, you know, requires some energy. The smaller the particle size, the energy required to inject an electron into the particle, you know, is larger. So that implies when we, you know, to use small metal nanoparticles, the particle size is small. So the electrons in the metal nanoparticle, you know, will be easily emit up, right, to inject into the surface absorbing molecules. So this reverse Coulomb blockade effect, you know, is proportional to the particle size. So, oh no, so it's reversely proportional to the particle size. That means, you know, so the tendency of emitting electrons from the metal nanoparticles become more easier when we reduce the particle size. So this, this electrical process, you know, occurs on the surface, and the efficient, you know, the high electron generation also near occurs near the metal nanoparticle surface. So all this, the both, you know, surface, you know, it's a quantum behavior like high electron generation and reverse Coulomb blockade effect, you know, it's can be very, you know, can be very, you know, it's predominant, you know, it's when the particle size, when the particle, you know, particle size fell in the range of 2 to 10 nanometers. So we call this type of metal nanoparticles as a quantum size metal nanoparticles to highlight the surface quantum behavior. Okay, so now, so the you know, this size dependence property of metal nanoparticles is not just limited for the, you know, it's a traditional conventional strong plasmonic golden silver nanoparticle. It can apply to the metal nanoparticles of any kind or any composition. So let's, you know, so next let's look at, you know, how can we, you know, so how can we achieve highly electron-driven photochemical reaction. So the photochemical reaction, you know, will occur on the surface of a metal nanoparticle catalyst, right? So the requirements involves, you know, it's, include the reacting molecules have to be adsorbed on the surface of a metal nanoparticle catalyst, right? The adsorption should be appropriate, right? And the metal nanoparticle should be able to strongly absorb light, in particular, you know, it's a visible light, you know, to better match the solar spectrum, right? Otherwise, there's no hot electron, you know, can be generated, right? So this another requirement is the hot electrons excited in the metal nanoparticles should have a strong tendency to inject into the surface adsorbing molecules in order to drive chemical reactions. So according to our previous discussion, so you know, so the quantum size of metal nanoparticles, you know, so can fulfill the first and the third requirement, right? Because, you know, we can choose, you know, it's a, you know, it's any metal nanoparticle we want, like, you know, and you know, a lot of, you know, it's a transition metal nanoparticle, you know, are good catalysts. That means, you know, it's a, they have good adsorption, you know, it's a big property to for interesting, you know, it's catalytic reactions. And also this quantum size can benefit these hot electron injection. But the challenge is, you know, so when we reduce the particle in size to the, you know, to a small region, 2 to 10 nanometers, so the light absorption power in the metal nanoparticles become low, right? So it's a significant challenge. So you know, we need to, you know, to absorb light in order to, you know, to in order to generate, you know, it's high electrons and drive chemical reaction. So how can we solve this challenge, you know, for, you know, it's for light absorption in these quantum size metal nanoparticles? In particular, for, you know, it's for the non-traditional plasmonic nanoparticles, their absorption, light absorption becoming even weaker. So, yeah, let's look at, you know, it's, some platinum group nanoparticles. You know, it's, they are very good, you know, catalysts for a lot of, you know, interesting reactions. So, but their light absorption power is weak. So, for example, you know, it's, the well dispersed, you know, it's, platinum nanocrystals with size of about, you know, 4 or 5 nanometers. How, you know, it's a featureless, you know, it's a broadband absorption in the visible regime, but they are weak. So how can we, you know, to increase the light absorption power in the small size, small metal nanoparticles? So one strategy, so we can use antenna effect, right? So like here, so the light absorption power in a small metal nanoparticle is proportional to the local electric field square, you know, rather than, you know, so the electric field of incident light. So it's a, and also it's a, you know, proportional to the volume of the particle. that means, you know, it's a small size of metal nanoparticle. It's not benefit for strong light absorption, right? So the local electric field, you know, give us a opportunity to tune, you know, to the light absorption power in the small metal nanoparticles. So that means that if we can, you know, increase the local electric field, so we should be able to increase the light absorption power in the small metal nanoparticles. So that, how can we realize that? So we need a light antenna. So here, so we can see, you know, so like the marble, the glass marbles. So even the glass does not absorb light, but the interaction with, you know, it's a light and the glass marble can change the behavior of the light propagation, like here. So we, you know, when we see the world, look at the world through the marble, you know, so it become upside down, right? So that means, you know, so in the highly symmetric, you know, it's a spherical glass beads. So the light, I mean, so the light can strongly scatter, you know, it's on the surface of the glass beads to generate scattering redness. The scattering redness can, you know, it's like constructive interference near the surface of the glass beads to generate enhanced electric field near the surface of the glass beads. So here shows an example, you know, for the 5-micron silicon beads. So you can say, you know, we can generate significantly enhanced electric field. It's a near field, you know, near the surface of the silicon beads, right? So that tells us, you know, since we are interested in the small quantum size of metal nanoparticles, right? So I mean, if we can put the small metal nanoparticles, you know, on the surface of a silica beads, you know, they can benefit the strongly enhanced local electric field to, you know, increase their light absorption power. So that means, you know, if we can create the small metal nanoparticle, like platinum nanoparticle on the silica beads, you know, it's this type of composite material. So they can be used to as a, you know, photocatalyst, you know, to strongly absorb light and drive chemical reactions. Yeah, let's say, you know, so this freestanding platinum nanocrystals, you know, when we put them on the silica beads, right? So we can say, you know, their light absorption in the visible region, you know, become different from the freestanding platinum nanocrystals. So we can say well-defined absorption peak in the visible region, right? And, you know, and the absorption becomes, you know, stronger. So these peaks, you know, it's not originated from the property of the platinum nanocrystals, right? It's correspond to the scattering redness of the silica beads. So this represents, you know, the peak position represents the scattering redness of the silica beads. So that means this peak can be changed by changing the size of the silica beads. Okay. So now we can say, you know, by using the metal silica composites, you know, it's a design composite structure, we can, you know, meet the requirement for a strong light absorption. So now, so this type of the composite structure, you know, it can fulfill all the requirements, all the, you know, basic requirement for efficient high electron driven photochemical reaction. So now let's look at an example, right? So what's, you know, for example, the example like oxidative dehydrogenation of primary alcohol to aldehyde, with ambient oxygen. So this reaction, you know, definitely cannot happen, you know, this, you know, cannot happen, you know, apparently, right? Even, you know, it's thermodynamically, you know, it's a spontaneous reaction, but kinetically it's very, very slow. So why? So otherwise, so we will not have wine to drink, right? So just if the reaction is very fast, so once we open the bottle, so the wine will be converted to a toxic aldehyde, right? So, but how can we, you know, accelerate the reaction kinetics? Of course, we can, you know, we can use catalytic process, right? So now we can say, you know, so here's a calculation result by Professor Schmidt, you know, at UC University of Wisconsin group. So we calculate the, you know, dehydrogenation of propanol to propanol. So here we can say the absorbing condition of oxygen on the catalyst can significantly influence the reaction kinetics. If it's, you know, it's like oxygen molecule type of absorption, so the activation energy barrier is very high. But if the oxygen becomes, you know, atomic type of absorption, the activation energy barrier can be lower significantly to accelerate the reaction. So that means the absorption condition of oxygen is important. So let's look at the oxygen absorption on platinum group nanoparticles. So, you know, here, you know, so we can see, you know, so when the absorption strength, you know, it's increases, they can form, you know, it's a different type of chemical absorption. It can be superoxide, you know, it's a type of absorption, or peroxide, you know, it's the bridge type, peroxide type of chemical absorption, or, you know, it's atomic type absorption. So on platinum, they tend to form superoxide type, you know, it's a linear type of absorption. So in this case, if we have, you know, the high electrons, you know, it's generated in the platinum, where the electrons, you know, so will go, right? They tend to, you know, so inject into the nearest, you know, the chemical bond, right? So once they inject it into the platinum, you know, it's an oxygen bond, this bond will be weakened and to help cleave this chemical bond, right? This and leading to the formation of superoxide radicals. So the oxygen molecule will take the electrons away to form superoxide radicals. So we know superoxide radicals, you know, have strong oxidation power to oxidize the alcohol. Here's an example. You know, under photo illumination, you know, it's the platinum on silica composite, you know, it's a catalyst, a can drive the oxidation of benzene alcohol. So in that case, so the superoxide radicals, you know, to take the high electrons, the oxygen molecule take a high electron to form superoxide radicals, which oxidize benzene alcohol to benzene aldehyde. And the holes, the positive charge left in the platinum nanoparticle can also oxidize alcohol to aldehyde. So we can say, you know, even with different substrates, the selectivity is pretty high. So, you know, it's over 90%. So we can confirm, you know, to the formation of superoxide radicals. So we can, you know, use electron spin redness spectroscopy. You know, we can say, you know, it's in dark, no signal, but in light, we can say, you know, it's a strong signal that indicates the formation of superoxide radicals. And also, if we use the superoxide radical scavenger to, you know, add a radical scavenger into the reaction system, we can say the conversion, that's a temple, it's a scavenger, the conversion of the oxidation reaction becomes less. It's reduced about, you know, it's 50%. That tells us, you know, it's confirms superoxide radicals, you know, it's indeed contributed to the oxidation of benzene alcohol to benzene aldehyde. On the other hand, so we can also add the whole scavenger, that's ammonium oxalate, to the reaction system. We can say the conversion of the reactant, you know, also reduced by, you know, about 50%. That tells us the holes also contributed to the oxidation of benzyl alcohol to benzyl anhydride. Right. That's for, but, you know, it's on different metal. The you know, it's the oxygen, you know, have different adsorption configuration. But on rhodium, the oxygen tend to form, you know, it's the bridge type of adsorption. That, you know, it's like a peroxide type adsorption. So in this case, if we photo excite the rhodium nanoparticle to generate hot electrons, so where the hot electrons go? So if we expect, you know, the hot electrons, you know, it can also go to rhodium oxygen bond to form the, you know, the radical anions. So if you know, we expect this, you know, that requires, you know, two electrons simultaneously inject into the two oxygen rhodium bond, right, to cleave the rhodium oxygen bond to form the radical anions. That will dramatically reduce the probability, right, because you need the two electrons to simultaneously inject, you know, it's into two oxygen rhodium bond at the same time. But in contrast, you know, if the electrons can inject into the oxygen bond, in this case, you know, so you don't need, you know, two electrons, you know, to simultaneously, you know, flow into the molecules, right? So in this case, so the oxygen bond, you know, can be weakened to form atomic type of adsorption, to form, you know, oxygen atoms. So we know oxygen atoms is, you know, it's more, it has a stronger oxidation power, right? So for example, that's a rhodium nanoparticle, you know, it's on silica beads. So it also shows similar light of, optical absorption in the visible region. So you can say, you know, it's by shining light of rhodium nanoparticles on silica beads. So, you know, it's the reaction kinetics is enhanced by about four times. That corresponds to reduce the activation energy by about 20 kilojoule per mole. Okay. So that definitely tells us, you know, the photo illumination, you know, to change the reaction, you know, the mechanism, right? So you can say, you know, so whether we do form, you know, the adsorb oxygen atoms under photo illumination. So yeah, right now we don't have, you know, it's a convincing decent, you know, spectroscopy data, but we followed the reaction kinetics by using the Langmuir-Hinshelwood reaction mechanism. So, you know, if the reaction is dominated by the bridge type adsorption, you know, still, you know, it's the associative, you know, it's an oxygen molecule. So the reaction rate is proportional to the partial pressure oxygen. But if the reaction is dominated by the oxygen atoms, so the reaction rate and the partial pressure of oxygen has to follow this equation. So here are the results. This is in the dark result. So you can see in the dark, the reaction rate is linearly, you know, it's dependent on the partial pressure of oxygen. That means it's this. So that means, you know, it's in the dark, the reaction is dominated by the, you know, it's associated, you know, oxygen molecule type, you know. So this is a slow, the reaction is a slow, right? But in the light, we can say the reaction rate is no longer proportional to the partial pressure of oxygen, but it, you know, it can fit by this equation. So that indicates, you know, say in analytes illumination, the, you know, so the oxygen becomes more likely, you know, it's an atomic type of oxygen, right? So yeah, it's this oxidation reaction. This type of then, you know, it's a strategy can also be applied to reduction reaction. For example, the natural benzene hydrogenation. You know, so natural benzene can go, you know, can be reduced to aniline or can form, you know, it's a coupling condensed product. You know, it's a different pathway. So you can say by using rhodium silica catalyst, so we can promotes the formation of isoxybenzene, and by using the platinum, you know, the catalyst, so we can, you know, it's promotes the formation of the phenyl hydroxyamine, you know, it's intermediate. So, okay, so also it can be extended to gas phase reaction. One example is like CO2 methanation. So can say, you know, it's a, you know, it's a CO2 react with hydrogen can form, you know, say both CO and say and methane, but and light. So we can say the CO, both, you know, formation, CO formation and the methane formation can be accelerated, but the CH4 formation can be accelerated much, much more than the formation of CO. So that means we can promote the, you know, selectivity of CH4, okay. So this, process, I mean, the results, you know, the benefits from the high electrons, which can accelerate the, you know, both step, you know, the CO2 to CO formation as well as a, you know, deeper hydrogenation of CO2 CH4. All right, so in summary, so yeah, we provide, you know, the glass beads as a type of a cheap light antenna that can enhance the optical absorption power in the quantum size metal nanoparticle catalyst. And then we can, you know, this quantum size metal nanoparticle and the photo illumination can efficiently generate hot electrons and also can efficiently inject hot electrons into surface adsorbates compared to the larger metal nanoparticle catalyst. So yeah, by using, you know, this type, you know, composite catalyst, so we can enhance, you know, the reaction kinetics and the selectivity of, you know, different types of reactions, including oxidation reaction, reduction reaction, you know, it's a solution phase reaction, a gas phase reaction. All right, finally, I would like to thank, you know, my students, you know, during this tough time, so the they're still working hard. So as, and also I appreciate the financial support by different, you know, agencies, as well as, you know, the collaborations. So, all right, thank you.